Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Please be seated. Welcome to the 23rd Annual Hooding and Graduation Ceremony of the Appalachian School of Law. My name is Keith Faulkner, and I'm privileged to serve as the President and Dean of the Law School. Thank you all for joining us this afternoon to recognize this amazing class, the class of 2022. As we formally introduce the ceremony today, I invite Pastor David Peters to the podium to provide our invocation. Pastor.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, in Jesus' name, we bow in your presence. It's our desire to begin this ceremony by praising and acknowledging you. You are the sovereign creator, sustainer, provider, and protector of all that's known and unknown, even our very lives. And at this time, we also want to thank you for the great gifts that you have given us. I thank you, God, for your mercy. I thank you for your grace. I thank you for forgiveness. Above all, I thank you for your love for us. For could we with ink the ocean fill? And were the skies of parchment made? Were every stalk on earth a quill and every man a scribe by trade? To write your love above would drain the ocean dry. Nor could the scroll contain the whole, though stretched from sky to sky. May every experience we have today bring glory and honor to you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you, Pastor. Grundy Baptist Church is a wonderful partner for Appalachian School of Law. They're one of many churches who support us and our students throughout each year, and we thank you. This is truly a joyous occasion. Today, we celebrate the accomplishments of students who will impact our beloved profession in profound and meaningful ways for years and decades to come. We honor all of our graduates and applaud the results of their many years of hard work and intense study through their undergraduate and law programs. This graduation represents a defining moment, the culmination of a lifetime of accomplishment, and a new beginning for each of them. The launch of these new careers in the profession of law is filled with limitless possibilities and promise and significant responsibilities. Commencement marks the traditional end of an academic program, but truly it is better understood as a beginning. For the past 3 years, graduates, you've been challenged to think like a lawyer, to negotiate like a lawyer, to communicate like a lawyer, and to advocate like a lawyer. You began this journey not knowing exactly what to expect, and now that it's at the end, I hope that you've enjoyed your study of law and commit yourselves to being lifetime learners, because that's what our profession demands. There's an unchanging fact that lawyers and judges know to be true. The law is always growing. New statutes are enacted and old statutes amended. Federal and state courts at every level daily issue new judicial interpretations of the law, sometimes changing the application of settled principles and other times unsettling principles previously thought to be unchangeable. You've been taught the law. That discipline is one that demands your daily struggle to understand and further develop. This is what's before you. This is what your new beginning looks like. I am pleased to welcome deans, faculty, staff, and special guests joining me on the platform today, particularly the Attorney General of the Commonwealth of Virginia, Jason Miaris. It is my hope that my immediate predecessor, and I do believe she has arrived, my immediate predecessor and friend, Justice Elizabeth McClanahan, she made it from that little school down the street, Virginia Tech. She left us to go to Virginia Tech, where she is remarkably busy, but she never fails to have time for ASL. So thank you for being here, Justice McClanahan. And thank you to the entire platform party. When I was fortunate to be offered the position to serve as president and dean, my kids said, smiling, "Wow, Dad, you are the boss. You're not going to have a boss at ASL." While I was flattered tremendously by their confidence in me, I was quick to correct them by explaining that I moved from having one boss at my old job to now a group of bosses at my new job, the ASL Board of Trustees. The kids' smiles faded quickly as the idea of a multi-headed mega boss kind of entered their imagination. However, I was fortunate to explain to them that we have a wonderful board of trustees at ASL, ones that are dedicated to the success of our students and this school and this region and our profession. The board of trustees is composed of dedicated volunteers who provide advice to the administration and serve as a policymaking body for the law school. Today, we have several trustees, some of my many bosses, present to share this day with us. Would members of the Board of Trustees please stand and remain standing for a moment to be recognized? Thank you. The Appalachian Law School of Law has been well served by other groups of hardworking volunteers as well. These include the officers and board of directors of the ASL Alumni Association. I ask that representatives of that group also stand, and you will be pleased to hear from our Alumni Association president near the end of our program today as she challenges the class of 2022. Alumni Association representatives, please stand if you're here. We're also very happy today to be joined by the law school faculty. These men and women, family members, are responsible for the agony, the pain, the tears, and the torture that your graduates have experienced over the last 3 years. The law faculty are culpable for the strange Thanksgiving conversations you had, those weird Christmas discussions that you could not understand, because they were employing the linguistic jiu-jitsu that the faculty has taught them as they expressed how to think like a lawyer. Families, you have been the guinea pigs for your students, and your dinner tables were the laboratories for them to test their advocacy and argumentative skills. Family members, please know that this fault lies entirely with the faculty, not with me. And I give you permission to blame them. My dear friends and colleagues on the faculty, in all seriousness, you're the lifeblood of this institution. You're dedicated teachers, but you're far more than that. You're the mentors that have grown the class of 2022 to be the next generation of citizen lawyers who we hope and pray will dedicate their professional lives to the advancement of a single yet incredibly noble ideal: the just and fair application of the rule of law to all persons, no matter their circumstances, and no matter how popular or unpopular their cause may seem to be at that moment in time. Graduates, in all seriousness, your professors have done their absolute best to prepare you to be lawyers. Now, I know you didn't think that when you were reciting in class, waiting on grades, or all those other fun things you did over the last 3 years that caused you great stress and turmoil. But all of their efforts and tactics have led you here, along with your own, and that is to wear the mantle of attorney and counselor at law. Thank you, faculty. Will you please stand and be recognized by this assembly and your graduates? I can tell you that this group is among the hardest working professionals and most talented educators I've ever met. I'd now ask that members of our law staff, whether on stage or in the audience, please stand and be acknowledged. Staff members, please stand if you're in the audience. Our law school, your law school, ASL, is a family, and our staff provides an endless amount of support to our students in so many ways. It does take a team effort to prepare the next generation of ASL lawyers to go out and capture the opportunities and understand the responsibilities they face entering practice. Thank you for all you do, staff. I want to particularly recognize folks who've worked on this graduation program. There are a lot of moving parts to what you see here today. And while it looks seamless from your seats, there's a tremendous amount of work that goes into it. Ms. Patty Lester, Glenna Owens, Gina Sauls, Brian Presley, Marcy Owens, Abigail Westcott, our security team, and hosts of others have worked tirelessly to put this program on for you to honor the class of 2022. Thank you for that hard work. Graduates, as I hope you have come to realize here at ASL, it's a truly special school. It's a truly special place. The courage shown by this community and our generous benefactors to start a law school in Southwest Virginia in the heart of Appalachia and in Grundy is inspiring. It's what fuels me every day to get up and try to drive ASL forward. It's what fuels your faculty, your staff. Thank you to the community and all of the people who help make ASL what it is. And we're going to continue to do that and make it even better. Thank you. Many may not believe this, but 25 years has passed. We will be celebrating our silver anniversary this year, 25 years of ASL in Grundy. And we are thrilled to have many momentous opportunities to celebrate that in the coming academic year, but I didn't want this program to leave without you knowing Grundy, Buchanan County, Commonwealth of Virginia, and well beyond that, how much you mean to our success and continued flourishing. So thank you. I am sure that many are here today and elsewhere who have gone that extra mile to assist these graduates in some way to reach their goal of attaining the moniker attorney and counselor at law. At this time, I ask the class of 2022 to recognize your parents, spouses, children, siblings, extended family members, friends, and all who have encouraged you along your pathway in law school. Please stand, class of 2022, and applaud your representatives. ASL is a school that is proud to serve the military and veteran communities. Each year, we are privileged to have members of the ASL community who desire to serve our country as lawyers in the Judge Advocate General's Corps for various branches of the armed services. Other members of this class are either on active duty or reserve duty and have held this status throughout their law school career. Many others in our community are veterans, many of them battle-tested. Some in our community are spouses and family members of these brave men and women. Thank you all for your service. However, at this time, I would ask that graduates who have served or are planning to serve the United States in the armed services, please stand for recognition and remain standing. I now invite all active duty service members and all veterans in the crowd to stand in solidarity with this group of students and graduates and be recognized for your service. Thank you all for your sacrifices to our great country. It is now my great honor and privilege to introduce you to our commencement speaker, the Attorney General of the Commonwealth of Virginia, Jason Miyares. Let me begin by telling you some basic facts about General Miyares. He has served as Attorney General of Virginia since January of this year. He earned his bachelor's degree in business administration from James Madison University and his JD, or his law degree, from the College of William and Mary School of Law. General Miyares' love and dedication to the Commonwealth and to the nation was instilled in him at a young age by his mother, Miriam, as she fled communist Cuba seeking freedom. As our Attorney General, our distinguished speaker now holds the title as the first Hispanic and Cuban American to be elected in any statewide office in Virginia. Prior to being elected Attorney General, General Miyares served as a prosecutor in the Virginia Beach Commonwealth's Attorney's Office. In 2015, almost 50 years after his mother fled Cuba, she voted for him to represent her in the oldest democracy in the Western Hemisphere, the Virginia House of Delegates. He served in the General Assembly from 2016 to 2022, and while representing his hometown of Virginia Beach, he was recognized as Legislator of the Year in both 2018 and 2019 from the College Affordability and Public Trust for his work on transparency and affordability in higher education. In 2019, he was also recognized by the Safe House Project for his work in combating human trafficking. General Miyares, to say that it's a great honor to have you here with us today is certainly an understatement. We're honored that you're here with us. Please join me in welcoming Attorney General Jason Miyares to today's celebration.
It is fantastic to be with you all today. It's also a little bit of a circle of life moment. This is the very first time since I was a law student that I put one of these on. So it's been a little bit surreal. I want to thank you, the Dean Faulkner, for your work and your leadership here at the Appalachian School of Law and your amazing leadership as well for this area of Virginia. For the students, this is an amazing moment for you. This is one of those days that you will remember the rest of your life. You will remember this day when you joined the ranks of the legal profession. I think it's important that we all, at this moment, take a pause and think what brought us here and brought you at this moment. In particular, Red Bull, coffee, Google, and Wikipedia. You know, I have to admit, not really having much experience doing graduation ceremonies, I did confess I looked at some other ones to see how did other speakers approach this, and it's a little interesting because what I found was you would have a situation of scores of students all dressed in identical gowns, all dressed with identical caps, hearing a commencement speaker telling them how individuality is the key to success. You're not gonna hear that speech from me today. As noted, I've been where you've been before, sitting in that seat, excited but also a little terrified, wondering, what am I going to do next? A little bit of a public service announcement. My office is hiring. Go to oag.state.va.us and go ahead and get your resume over to us. I remember the stress of job interviews. I remember sitting at a rather prestigious law firm in Norfolk with some very somber-minded partners at the firm, and they asked me, how did I do academically in law school? And I said, well, you know the top 10%? And they said, yes. I said, I'm the guy who makes the top 10% possible. Needless to say, I did not end up working at that law firm. But that's okay. It is a terrifying moment, but it is also an exciting moment. In all seriousness, you are joining one of the noblest professions in the world. And trust me, I have heard every lawyer joke. Yes, it's true, 95% of lawyers give the rest of us a bad name. But if you think out throughout all of human history, when people tried to resolve conflict, it was might makes right. If I have the power, whether it's a bigger army or more control over your life, whoever had the power, if there was a dispute, that person with the power would win. Didn't matter whether they were right or wrong. And you had these little glimmers of hope. You have about 4,000 years of civilization, and you saw something remarkable happen. The first time in recorded history, actually, was in the Torah, in the book of Leviticus, in chapter 19. When the very first moment in recorded human history, the concept of equal protection under the law entered human civilization. When it talked about how you were to treat the rich and the poor the same under the law. Now for us, that's as normal as breathing air. The reality, I don't care if you think it was from Providence or you think just Moses was a really wise legal scholar back in ancient Israel. The reality, it was one of the most transformative moments. There's a reason why a statue of Moses is at the United States Supreme Court. And it's not because the justices went to Sunday school. Because they realized that he was one of the earliest lawgivers. It also is one of those traditions that have made this country so unique. There's been reference about my mother, who fled Cuba with nothing but the clothes on her back. And I love to speak at high school groups, and I ask them, why did my mother come here? What was so unique about this country? Well, obviously, Spain was a much better fit for her culturally. It was because she was desperate to live in a society that recognized that her rights didn't come from government. They were given to her by God. Have no doubt that we're unique. We're a unique nation. If you don't think that, and everybody here on this beautiful Saturday afternoon, I want you to pause and think of this. Wherever you're seated right now, at this very moment, there are millions of people on this planet that would do everything in their power. They would crawl over broken glass. They would cling to the side of an airplane to be seated exactly where you're seated right now. That's to be an American. That is an amazing, amazing gift. I've said before that what separates us from most of the people that woke up this morning on this planet is the knock on the door. See, if you hear that, you don't think anything of it. In my case, it's usually Amazon Prime's dropping something off, or my golden retriever got out again. For most of the people who woke up this morning, when they hear this, it means something very different. It means the powers that be are there to take them away because they worship God in a manner they disagree with, or they've spoken out for human rights or human dignity. That simple knock changes how so many people on this planet live their life compared to how you live yours. My mother heard that knock in Cuba. When during the Bay of Pigs invasion, Castro's secret police showed up at her home to take away her brother, my uncle, Angel Miarez. He was taken away, no due process, they didn't read him his rights, he never went in front of a judge. He was taken to an empty baseball stadium, suffered the humiliation of a mock execution. A country 90 miles off our shore, and people were living over their shoulders in fear. And we bask under the altar of freedom, and we barely recognize that this is indeed a miracle. It's the American miracle. We think we live our lives as a normal human being's reality. We live our lives in a very unique manner. Freedom of speech is rare, unique, and a miracle. Freedom of religion is rare and unique and a miracle. Freedom of the press is rare and unique and is a miracle. Margaret Thatcher once said that all the nations in Europe emerged out of a history, but America is the only country to ever emerge out of a philosophy. Or as G.K. Chesterton noted, America is the only country in the history of the world to ever be founded on a creed. What is that creed? I think the American that best captured that was Dr. Martin Luther King on the steps in the Lincoln Memorial, where he talked about those inalienable rights in the Declaration of Independence. He referred to that as the promissory note made to every American, past, present, and future. And he was there to collect on that promissory note. Who wrote that promissory note? It was a quiet, unassuming Virginia lawyer from Charlottesville. He was not a very good public speaker, but Mr. Jefferson was an amazing thinker. And he wrote the mission statement for our country, because America is not a place as much as it is an idea. It's why a robust legal education that values freedom of speech is so critical to preserving this miracle, and why Appalachian School of Law is such a critical component of keeping it for the next generation. It has become somewhat fashionable in today's age to trash America, to say that somehow this country is inherently evil. I had a veteran come up to me talking about this, and he said, this is a national security issue. How do you recruit young men and women to be able to serve in their country if they're told that this is somehow an irredeemable, broken one? To the men and women that are standing on the wall, those that are going to serve from this law school class and those that have, thank you. There's a saying in Oregon that says, you don't know how tall a tree is until it's been knocked down. Woe be us as a country if America is ever knocked down. Because we're the most successful, multiracial, multiethnic, multireligious society in the history of the world. And if you don't believe me, go to our naturalization ceremony. It's my earliest memory as a child of seeing my mother become a U.S. citizen. It's my favorite thing to do as an elected official. The last one I went to, there was 116 people from 57 different countries. As I'd love to say, it's a great honor of my life to be among the first to welcome you to our American family. They understand that this is indeed the last best hope on earth. If you want a more visual representation, then after today's graduation ceremony, go on YouTube and watch the last year's Summer Olympics in Tokyo, Japan, the Parade of Nations. 119 countries walk in. Only one country. Only one. When they walk in, looks like the entire world. The delegation looks from every faith, every race, every creed, and it's the United States. I was speaking at a high school. I can tell I don't know how to wear these things, right? I was speaking at a high school, a private high school. Tuition costs more than this law school. And I was speaking to a group of students, and I had a young man challenge me. He did not think America was intrinsically good or decent. And I said, I'd never said America is a perfect country, but we are a noble one. And he said, prove it. So I realized we live in an age where everybody lives by this device. And I told this young man, I said, take out your phone. I'm going to tell everybody here, you have special dispensation. You could take out your phone. Some of you may already be on it, it's okay. But take out your phone right now. I want you to type in three words, as I told this young man. Type in Google, Korea at night. Do it right now. Korea at night. And if you do, pulls up, you see a satellite image of Korea from space. And I asked this young man, you have a peninsula where they all speak the same language or the same people, but half of it, there's light. People right now are going to a play. They're picking up the newspaper that criticizes their government. They can vote and determine who their leader is. There's light. And then you look in the north and there's darkness. There's utter, complete darkness. And I asked this young man, why? What happened? And I realized he didn't know. I don't call the Korean War the Forgotten War for nothing. And I told him it's because close to 40,000 Americans crossed an ocean, went to a land that they never even knew the language, didn't know the people. They fought, they bled, and they died defending a people, one of the worst forms of tyranny the world had ever seen in Soviet communism. They didn't ask for treasure, they didn't ask for glory, and the only land they asked for was a place to bury their dead. If that's not an example of nobility, I don't know what is. It's important for us as lawyers, as you enter in this profession, to always recognize that part of what makes this miracle possible is the concept that you could disagree with somebody and not be disagreeable. That civility is not weakness. Our politics in America has gotten rather coarse. Candidly, both parties have been guilty of it. I had a Marine and a close friend point out to me that if you go to Arlington National Cemetery and you walk among those Stars of David's and those crosses, there's not an R or a D next to anyone's name. And never forget that someone that maybe disagrees with you politically has given their last full measure of devotion for this amazing, magnificent country. In other words, the person that disagrees with you politically is not your enemy. So let's stop acting like it. As lawyers, remember you are an heir to an amazing tradition. Reminds me of what an Italian immigrant said when he first spied the Statue of Liberty. He said, that is the greatest light the world has ever seen since the Star of Bethlehem. We are that light. I want to recognize the uniqueness and the mission of the Appalachian School of Law. 20% of Americans live in rural areas, but less than 2% of lawyers do. Part of their mission is to make sure that every American and every Virginian has legal representation so they can also understand that might doesn't make right, that they have protection under the law. It's a magnificent mission. I'm proud to be here to help you support you in this mission. I'll end with this. Ronald Reagan once made this observation. He said, of all the countries in the world, the United States is the only country, the only one, in which our national anthem actually ends with a question. Are we still the land of the free and the home of the brave? That's a question that has to be answered by every generation. My prayer is that answer is always yes. Thank you to the graduates, class of 2022, for your role in preserving the American miracle. Thank you to the fathers, the mothers, the wives, the family members that dealt with a lot of stressed out students, particularly during finals. Thank you for your grace, thank you for your love, and thank you for your support for them. To the graduates, you're about to join one of the most noble professions in human history. You're about to join a profession that indeed will continue what Abraham Lincoln noted, that we're the last best hope on earth. Thank you for being part of that last best hope. God bless you.
General Meares, thank you so much for those powerful remarks and reminding the class of 2022 and any and all lawyers in here that we are the guardians of the rule of law. And what you do on a daily basis matters. It matters to you, matters to your clients, matters to your community, our states, and this nation. The Appalachian School of Law student body is enriched by students from many parts of our country. Central to the school's mission, however, is providing educational opportunities for students from our region. I am very proud to have the opportunity to introduce today a graduating student who is very much representative of ASL and what it is all about. Our valedictory speaker, Ann Charles Dodd, is a native of the Shenandoah Valley. She grew up in Stanton, Virginia, and graduated from Robert E. Lee High. Upon graduating from high school, Ms. Dodd attended James Madison University in Harrisonburg, Virginia, where she earned a Bachelor of Arts in Communication Studies and a Bachelor of Arts in Dance. At ASL, Ann Charles has served as the chair of the Moot Court Board, as an officer of multiple organizations on campus, including Phi Delta Phi International Legal Honor Society, the Criminal Law Society, the Christian Legal Society, and the Business and International Law Society. Ann Charles has received recognition as an individual, but also for Appalachian School of Law through her participation in moot court competitions. Ms. Dodd credits her success at Appalachian School of Law to the encouragement and strength shown to her by her fiance, her family, and her closest friends during the hardest times of law school. Please welcome me in joining and welcoming to the stage the valedictorian of the class of 2022, Ann Charles Dodd.
Thank you, Dean Faulkner, and thank you to the faculty and staff, and a special thank you to our families and friends for being here with us today. Class of 2022, it's hard to put into words how honored I am to share in this special moment with all of you. For many of us, it's been a long journey just to arrive at this very place. For many of us, each and every one of us have had to overcome our own individual challenges, but we have. Some of you are raising children while going to law school. Some of you had long commutes just to attend school every day. And some of you battled personal obstacles. And some of you moved all the way across the country to the coal fields of Southwest Virginia to chase your dreams. Not even a global pandemic could stop us. Michelle Obama once said that success is about the difference that you make in people's lives. I found that many of you are kind, resilient, and dedicated. Being at a small school, we saw each other every single day. We celebrated each other on the good days, lifted each other up on the bad days, and carried each other through every single stretch of horrible final exams. ASL is a really special place, full of good people. Anytime someone missed class, there are at least two or three people that would make sure that the student that had missed class had notes. And if someone missed class unexpectedly, you could always count on the fact that they had text messages from at least one person making sure that they were okay. I can't count how many times I've heard of students making each other dinner or students dropping everything that they were doing to help a friend in need, no matter the size of the request. By these actions alone, we've all made a difference in each other's lives. Former United States Secretary of State Colin Powell once said that a dream doesn't become reality through magic. It takes sweat, determination, and hard work. I would use those same words to describe the class of 2022, determined and hardworking. Time and time again, the class of 2022 has shown their unwavering determination in times of adversity. There were numerous opportunities to give up, and you all consistently persevered. Your hard work throughout the past 3 years has been nothing short of inspirational. It's been a pleasure to get to know all of you. I'd be honored to serve and work alongside any of you. And I pray that you continue to work hard and continue to make a difference in each other's lives. And I look forward to hearing about all the great things that you accomplished. Congratulations, we've finally done it.
thank you for those great remarks, Ms. Dodd. It is now my pleasure to call upon Mr. Mason Height, Chief Academic Officer of the Appalachian School of Law. He will read the names of the class of 2022 and present the graduates for hooding by the Honorable Chadwick S. Dotson, Chairman of the Virginia Parole Board and former ASL faculty member. Some graduates, you will notice, will be hooded by family members who are lawyers or by other legal mentors who hold the JD degree. Dean Height and Judge Dotson.
Alyssa N. Biamonte. Ms. Biamonte is being hooded by Adrienne Giordano, her aunt, a graduate of Stetson University. Dina Marie Carlosi. Megan Elizabeth Chamberlain. Alexander R. Colelli. Patrick Blake Cockrell. Mr. Cockrell is being hooded by the Honorable Clifford L. Clay Attlee, Jr., his uncle, and a judge on the Virginia Court of Appeals, a graduate of Dayton School of Law. Michelle Rose Delafave. And Charles Dodd. Miss Dodd is being hooded by Miller Moreau, her fiance and graduate of Campbell University. Lindsay J. Ellis. Miss Ellis is being hooded by Mary McGeorge, her friend and mentor and graduate of ASL. Gabrielle Michelle Englander. Ms. Englander is being hooded by Caitlin A. Young, her mentor and employer, and also a graduate of the Appalachian School of Law. Donald Ray Epperson II. Ryan James Franceschina. Mr. Franceschina is being hooded by Kimberly Farmer, his mentor, and a graduate of West Virginia University School of Law. Christopher C.J. Grisham. Ellie Hassani. Rebecca Johnson Hickey. Brandy Lee Hurley. Brandon J. Johnson. Mr. Johnson is being hooded by Jennifer Phillips Fielding, his mother, and a graduate of Georgia State University. Brittany Michelle Jones. Ms. Ms. Jones is being hooded by Ernest J. Wright, her mentor and a graduate of Case Western University School of Law. Kristen Michelle Justice. Logan Alexander Leftwich. Mr. Leftwich is being hooded by Jay Leftwich, his father, and a graduate of the T.C. Williams School of Law at the University of Richmond. Shane Lester. Jacob Abraham Maldonado Gonzalez. Brielle Lene McKinley. Tyler Drew Melton. Christina Marie Morgan. Keith George Napolitano, Jr. Kyle Joseph Newsom. Chuck Samuel Okereke, Jr. Jocelyn Verily Revelorio. Marcus Lee Russell. Mr. Russell is being hooded by Mark A. Green, his friend and mentor, and a graduate of Atlanta's John Marshall School of Law. Michaela Josefina Salazar. Bronte Stalgard. Travis Keith Tackett. Bianca Y. Valdez. Ms. Valdez is being hooded by Shannon Adams, her friend and mentor, and a graduate of the Appalachian School of Law. Austin Wyatt Wilson von Henner. Sebastina A. Wiafe. Elias Stephen Webb. Mr. Webb is being hooded by Stephen K. Webb, his father, and a graduate of the University of Richmond School of Law. James Nicholas Whitaker. Bartholomew Paul Biesla. Dean Faulkner, these candidates have completed the requirements for the degree of Juris Doctor. Upon recommendation and approval of the faculty, I present them to you for the conferral of that degree.
By the authority vested in me by the Board of Trustees, and with the approval of the faculty, I confer upon each of you the degree of Juris Doctor upon the completion of the requirements with all the rights, privileges, and responsibilities appertaining thereto. You may move your tassels. I'm now pleased to welcome to the podium Mary Rachel Wolf, who will issue the Alumni Challenge to the graduating class. Mary Rachel Wolf is the president of the Alumni Association for Appalachian School of Law. Rachel is a native of Southwest Virginia, a 2010 graduate of Transylvania University, a 2013 graduate of the Appalachian School of Law, and a 2019 graduate of Georgetown University Law Center. While a student at ASL, Rachel served 3 years on the Student Bar Association, was an editor for the Appalachian Journal of Law, and served as an extern for the Supreme Court of Virginia. After her graduation in 2013, she completed a clerkship at the Wise County Circuit Court for 2 years before joining the private practice firm of Wolf, Williams, and Reynolds, where she has litigated federal black lung claims since 2015. Rachel is an adjunct professor at ASL and also currently serves the Virginia State Bar within the many conferences. Please join me in welcoming Ms. Rachel Wolf as she offers the Alumni Challenge to the class of 2022.
Thank you, Dean Faulkner, Board of Trustees, faculty and staff, parents, friends and family, distinguished guests, and of course, the class of 2022. I'm so thankful that the lights are back on and I can read my speech. But I'm so honored to speak to the class of 2022 today to present the Alumni Challenge. I graduated in 2013, and I attribute a lot of my own success and personal growth to the Appalachian School of Law. Since I was a child, I've been a terribly shy person, and in fact, I still consider myself to be somewhat timid. During my first week of ASL, I decided that I was going to run for Student Bar Association. I went up to all my new classmates in August of 2010, and introduce myself. Hi, I'm Rachel, and I'm running for SBA Senator, and I would appreciate your vote. I won my senator seat that year by a landslide. I still don't know what to this day gave me the courage to speak to over 100 complete strangers, but as I look back on it, I think ASL provided me a comforting and safe environment where I was allowed to blossom in the person that I was meant to become. Strangely enough, the stressful and sometimes nerve-wracking situations that only law school seems to guarantee, I had the courage to make an oral argument in my appellate advocacy class my second year, run for vice president my third year, and survive the Socratic method all 3 years of law school. Those experiences, although somewhat stressful for me personally, still to this day give me the confidence in my current legal career to look past my fears. I'm positive that the past 3 years, the uncomfortable demands of law school have allowed growth in your own personal journey as well. Before I present the Alumni Challenge, I would like to talk about two additional tasks I have been assigned today as one of my last official acts as president of the Alumni Association. The Alumni Association traditionally gives a $500 check to each class's valedictorian to reward their hard work and for a stipend to study for the bar examination this summer. Before commencement today, I had the honor to present Ann Charles Dodd with that check. Congratulations, Ann, on your great accomplishment of graduating first in your class. My second task today is to welcome the class of 2022 to the ASL Alumni Association. Now that your degree has been conferred by Dean Faulkner, you are officially part of a network of over 1,500 ASL alumni. I hope that Grundy has felt like home for the past 3 years, and my wish is that you embrace your alumni identity and use this new identity to help benefit you and others in the future. We welcome you to become active in our organization, network with our members, keep in touch with your classmates and faculty, and return to Grundy and tell us of your future successes and personal milestones. You made an investment in attending ASL, and now the ASL Alumni Association would like to make an investment in your life and support you in your future endeavors. To present my alumni challenge to you, I'm going to talk about mountains. We talk about mountains a lot in this town, in this region, and even when describing our law school. We are situated in the heart of the Appalachian Highlands. We present ourselves as a school surrounded by the solitude of mountains, where you have the space to think and focus on your studies We pride ourselves on educating lawyers who will practice in these mountains and beyond. The faculty and staff have even embraced a new motto that our school will move mountains in achieving the highest degree of education and professional excellence in this country. I recently read a book about mountains titled The Second Mountain, A Quest for a Moral Life by New York Times op-ed columnist David Brooks. Mr. Brooks uses the metaphors of a first mountain and a second mountain to describe our value systems in life. The first mountain we seek to achieve in life is one that values yourself. The second mountain is a value system that values relationships and service to others over self. Both mountains are important to the life we create, but Mr. Brooks argues that that second mountain gives us joy and fulfillment in life. If we follow Mr. Brooks's logic, this commencement today is a high achievement of your first mountain. Society has ingrained in us instructions to get degrees, find high-paying jobs, and continually add to our resume. The diploma you now hold in your hand and the new initials you have earned beside your name, JD for Juris Doctor, allow you a chance to be more employable in today's competitive world and not just create a career, but a livelihood. The existence of this law school, the demanding curriculum, the stress of studying for exams, and the sacrifices you have personally made the past 3 years were all to get you to this first mountain. The family and friends sitting on your left and right of you today are here to celebrate your hard work that has led you to this personal achievement. Toast at the graduation celebration tonight will be made in your honor, and I hope you savor the moment this special occasion brings. Even the next step in this journey of taking and passing the bar examination will be a high peak of that first mountain, although from my personal experience, studying for the bar exam will be a hard, somewhat treacherous, and sometimes lonely valley. But I promise that if you have the grit to make it to this day, you also have the grit to make it through the bar exam. The first mountain is important because it gives you self-satisfaction and the opportunity to create the life you have envisioned for yourself. However, a greater joy in life comes from that second mountain. Mr. Brooks states that we work on that second mountain when we make commitments to at least one of the four pillars of life, those being family and a spouse, a vocation, a philosophy or a religion, and a community. Two of those pillars of commitment stand out to me as I speak to you today: vocation and community. I truly believe that almost all of you might already be focused on that second mountain by choosing the profession of law and being members of the ASL community these past 3 years. A vocation is defined as a strong feeling or suitability for a particular career or occupation. All of you have chosen the legal profession as your future career, despite the costs, stress, and demands of law school. While I hope it gives you the personal prestige and stability that are satisfactions of that first mountain, the legal profession will provide you limitless ways to serve others. While the legal profession is incredibly broad, you have gained the tools, analytical skills, and communication methods to not only represent your future clients, but to create a more fair and just world in whatever area of the law you choose. You will have the opportunity to work on causes important to you and find meaning in that particular field of law. Many of you will become prosecutors to help provide justice to victims of crime, community leaders or public servants to create a more equitable society, public defenders to promote fairness through fair procedures, environmental lawyers to ensure a planet exists for future generations. The legal profession also provides the opportunity to become models of ethical integrity in the communities you go back to. When your future clients come for your expertise, they will be asking for advice on what might be the worst day of their life, whether from being injured in a car accident, escaping a domestic violence situation, being accused of a crime they did not commit, or those that face racial or sexual discrimination in the workplace. The legal profession gives you the opportunity to help people in their most dire time and need. Law school is time-consuming, stressful, and a costly endeavor, and I believe all of you wouldn't have made it here today if you did not have that higher calling of pursuing a vocation that gives you purpose rather than just a prestigious title. Additionally, during your last 3 years at ASL, you have exemplified that you are focused on the pillars of community. All of you have gone above and beyond in serving others in the community of Southwest Virginia during your time here. I know that the legal profession is in good hands if based on the leadership and community service you have demonstrated the past 3 years. For example, here are some extraordinary acts of service by the members of the class of 2022. Alex Kalehi traveled regularly up mountain roads, sometimes over an hour, to Wise and Dickinson counties to assist with substance abuse prevention events and drug court. Gabrielle Englander regularly volunteered as a court-appointed special advocate for CASA to advocate for children who have experienced abuse and neglect. Lindsay Ellis, a veteran of the U.S. Navy, who volunteered as a Special Olympics basketball coach before attending ASL, stated she wished to make a difference when she started law school. She's volunteered as a children's advocate for CASA even during the pandemic and after having a baby last year. Two of my former students in my Black Lung class, Brandy Hurley and Nick Whitaker, helped organize food and supply drives to assist victims in Hurley and Buchanan County by the recent flood and mudslides. Each person in the class of 2022 performed at least 50 hours of community service this past year, collectively adding up to 2,050 hours of community service while juggling a full study load, filling out bar exam applications, and fulfilling your own personal and family obligations. Despite being enrolled at this institution to serve yourself, you have looked outside of yourself to create a better life for others. This service to community demonstrated by all of you will give you a firm foundation of self-worth when you have failures, roadblocks, and setbacks in life. Continued service to others will give you purpose during the hard times and pull you out of the valleys that life sometimes presents. My challenge to you today is while you are achieving accolades in your first mountain, as you should, to remember what Mr. Brooks calls the second mountain, an attempt to live a life of service to others by making a commitment to a pillar of life. The legal profession can often be draining in meeting deadlines, juggling the needs and desires of clients, and making sure you can account for a certain number of billable hours, but in the stress of this demanding career, I promise you gain a greater satisfaction in life if you remember to serve others and make a difference in people's lives. Whether you're on your first mountain or your second mountain, or maybe a combination of both today, attempt to make the emotional rewards of helping others outweigh the financial rewards of your job. Be a mentor to a new and upcoming attorneys the same way your mentors have given opportunities to you. Use your degree to form relationships with people to make the world a better place. Don't just strive to be a successful lawyer, but strive to be a good person that impacts others in ways big and small. I wish you the best on the bar examination this summer and in this new journey you are now embarking on. Congratulations, class of 2022.
Thank you, Rachel, and thank you to all the alumni who continue to support the Appalachian School of Law and our graduates in so many wonderful ways. I'd like to briefly add to Rachel's challenge. Briefly, I was told by one of the graduates as I crossed the stage, wrap it up. So it'll be brief, I promise. Class of 2022, alumni of Appalachian School of Law, you are alumni. You are ASL. Our alumni is ASL. You will serve your communities, whether they be in Southwest Virginia or far beyond, with the grace, the integrity, and the character that will certainly carry forward the name of ASL in great pride. I'd like to give you a quote from Albert Einstein. And some of you may say, I heard that at the awards banquet. I was 4 hours in at that point, so I don't know if you heard it or not, so I wanted to repeat it. And it ties directly into what Ms. Wolf just told you. Try not to be a man of success, Einstein said, but rather try to become a man of value. Graduates, I want you to remain seated, and I ask that our entire audience rise, if possible, again, and congratulate you on this accomplishment. Thank you all. This class, the class of 2022, is going to make an impact, and they're going to help people, and they're going to serve people. So we're very thrilled for them. The program will conclude in just a moment with our benediction offered by Pastor Peters. Immediately following the benediction, the recessional will begin. The platform party will lead the recessional, followed by the faculty and trustees, and lastly, the class of 2022. We ask that the audience remain standing at your seats during the recessional. Graduates, as you process out, you will be greeted with handshakes as the faculty lines the sideline as you walk by. Your new peers, not your faculty anymore, your new professional peers. And I will tell you, we are thrilled to welcome you into this profession. Lastly, many of you will want to rush out, graduates. As you process down and shake the hands of the faculty, please go out this door and then come right back in this door, because we're going to take a class picture of all of you adorned in your graduation regalia. So we're excited about that. And tonight I have been promised a real Southwest send-off for you from the numerous staff members who've worked so hard to put this event together at the farewell celebration. Please come out. We want to just have a great time with you and send you off in the right way. Doors open at 6 o'clock, and we look forward to seeing you there. Pastor Peters, will you deliver our benediction?
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, again in Jesus' name, we bow in your presence. Just as we opened up this ceremony to turn our face toward you, I humbly ask that you would turn your face to these graduates. Some of them have plans and they've got it all figured out. But we know that the future is very uncertain. Some may face tragedy, loss. Some may face victory and joy. But I pray for each of them that you would bless them, that they would put their life in your hands and let you guide them for the rest of their life. In Jesus' name.